first of all, Adam, welcome to the High 11 podcast. Thanks for giving us some time. I know you're out there, it's fight week in Houston. I'm assuming a busy week for you. How's things been going so far this week?
Yeah, pretty good. We got kind of used to Vegas, you know, because they'd done a bunch of fights in that little kind of that little village that they have kind of cornered off. So Houston's a little different because it's just a hotel that's open to the public and stuff. We're like back in an actual city instead of just being in like a place off the strip. So it's a little different. Like it's weird being able to walk down a bar and get a drink again, but it's kind of nice, you know. It's a welcome change.
How's it been in distance? Obviously, I know Angela's been really busy of late. She's been one of the more active fighters in the UFC roster. How is this fight week compared to previous ones you've been involved in, obviously, right in the heart of the pandemic?
Well, it's Texas, so there's no real... Texas doesn't really give a shit about rules, anything like that. You know, like, the first thing I'm seeing when I, like, you know, you walk downtown and stuff is no one's wearing masks, everyone's not... You know, it's Texas, it's whatever. But it's pretty much the same. Like, the UFC encourage you to stay in the hotel. They don't want you to go out and catch COVID. Because, you know, even, like, last week they had, like, three cancellations, like, the day leading up to the fights and stuff. So they're aware that it's an ongoing issue. But at this point, you know, me and Angie are vaccinated. Most of the team's vaccinated that we're with. And, you know, we're doing what we can. It's just trying to avoid doing stupid stuff like going in crowds of people and things like that. But... you never know. I'm sure we'll get a bunch of pullouts again, but it's not been too bad. It's again, it's kind of refreshing because a lot of the media stuff, like all the press conference things and stuff like that, most of it's done in the hotel itself.
Yeah.
So it saves you from the walk around, and it's actually easier to do things remotely for like Angela and the rest of the fighters, because you just have to hop on a Zoom call or take a phone call instead of having to like schlep across town to like, you know, some random place through traffic and stuff like that. So it's a little easier, and it's just a little calmer. But this one, because it's a bigger fight, it's just been a little busier for Angela. So it's, you know, keeping her occupied.
Yeah, and just for some of your viewers that maybe are picking up that Scottish twang in the accent there, it's definitely still there.
I know, this is the sad thing, like, but Angela gives me shit, my parents give me shit, like it's almost gone, you know what I mean? So I've been in America 11, 12 years now, something like that, but I'm from Edinburgh, so like, you know, it was mild to begin with. I'm not like, you know, and when Angela hears people with accents and stuff, like when Ross Pearson was through the gym and stuff like that, she would have a conversation with him and wouldn't know what the fuck he was saying. Like, she'd turn around and just like, you know, ask me, what did he say? And I'm like, I'm not gonna translate it for you, you know? So I still understand it, but it's very watered down to compare to what it used to be. So, you know.
I know you and Angela were obviously out in Scotland. I think it was just post before everything kicked off with COVID and stuff like that. How did Angela get on with the accents when she was out in Edinburgh?
Well, she's used to my folks now and stuff. It's not too bad. And I've got a few friends with very thick accents, so she's you know, she's used to it by now. She still watches, like, if we watch something on Netflix, like a British thing, she has to put on subtitles and stuff sometimes. But other than that, you know, she does okay. Yeah.
For you, like you say, you've been out in the States for, what, 11, 12 years. I'd love to know how did you end up going out to the States? What got you going out there? What was it that moved you across the pond?
Well, Angela and I met when we were still in college. So I went to like Glasgow School of Art. You know the Rennie McIntosh building in Glasgow?
Yeah.
And I know it like burned down or something recently, but I was studying there and she was studying at a place called Cooper Union in New York. Mm-hmm. And so we were, we met on student exchange in Japan when we were both like, happened to be there at the same time. And then we kind of dated like long distance for a while. And then I moved over to the States for a couple of months just to see how it worked out. We got married in City Hall and stuff like that, and then did the immigration thing. And so that's how, you know, that's how I ended up here. Married an American girl.
So was it you then that got Angela into combat sports, into, I'm assuming, Muay Thai at first?
Well, we hadn't actually done anything. We got married and, you know, we were getting like fat and stuff like that. And I was still in like my early 20s and Angela was in her early 20s. So we started really late, but... you know, coming from Scotland that has a pretty strong Thai boxing scene, you'd assume that I did it over there, but I didn't. I hadn't done anything. And we started together as like a something we could do that was like fun as a couple instead of joining a gym. And, you know, we could have accidentally ended up joining some kind of kung fu school or something like that, but we didn't. So we found an Australian dude, Brandon Levi, who who taught at a place called Fight House, which was in New York, and he was our original Muay Thai coach. That was Angela and I's coach throughout like our whole amateur career, her professional career, stuff like that. So, you know, it worked out. It was good, and she excelled at it, and she kept kind of, she picked up the MMA thing and stuff, and I just essentially ended up working as like a pad holder, kind of almost on the side, yeah. And you know, and I think I'm better suited to that. So
yeah
it's good. But yeah, go ahead.
James Dillon, who's a head coach at higher level, he normally does the show with mm-hmm. us. Unfortunately, he couldn't make it tonight, but he did shoot me a couple of things he wanted to ask you. He wanted to know, and I don't know if you're able to answer this, what the Thai scene in the UK is like versus the Thai scene out in America.
Well, it's kind of, because I wasn't involved in it back home, it's kind of hard to know, but you see so many, I mean, occasionally, most of like the big Muay Thai shows we got in, and even like, and again, I'm not particularly involved with the Muay Thai scene here. I mean, like I used to be a little more into it and stuff, but the guys I mostly work with are MMA fighters and stuff. But you see a lot of American fighters. Like I know Kevin Ross just retired and stuff like that, but the kind of the Triumphant show and stuff on the West Coast, is it Triumph or Triumph? I can't remember. But that it's all kind of West Coast fighters. You get a lot of West Coast fighters, and then you get a New York. It's like a totally different scene because New York had a different rule set for a while with WKAs. You can use elbows. It wasn't technically like full rules or something like that. But you find that a lot of British fighters are just of a, there's great American fighters, but it's stylistically very different. Even the little bit I follow on Instagram, like Ben Willis and stuff like that, completely different to what you get in the States. And I think maybe it's just maybe an intermingling with the whole kind of MMA scene here. Like if you're a Thai boxing school or something like that, it's, who's calling me?
No, that's all right. Don't worry about that.
Sorry. You still see me okay? Aye, sorry.
Yeah, you're good.
It's like West Coast to East Coast, it's like, it's very, very different. You have, because in New York, it was very like, you couldn't fight with elbows for so long. And I think Angela was one of the first, maybe the first female full rules main event in like New York history or something like that, when she was still doing Friday Night Fights, which is a promotion on the East Coast. But they'd still fly in like Irish kids and stuff like that. And Irish kids would kick the shit out of people and stuff, you know? So it's like, I mean, honestly, like name-wise, I couldn't, I got no idea who's relevant at the moment. But it's just a bigger scene, I guess, in Scotland and England. Yeah. It's just a bigger competitor pool. I think here people see it as supplementary to going in something like MMA or something like that. And yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, I've got to leave, obviously. No, that's all right.
What a terrible answer.
you would assume that obviously America, with the UFC being so prevalent over there, we don't see them as much in the UK and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So the MMA scene in America is obviously over the last 10, 15 years has just blew up. And I want to talk a wee bit about Angela's fight coming up against Tisha Torres, but I want to go back a wee bit because this is a rematch. I believe the last fight was actually over 6 years ago now.
But
when Angela fought that fight, she was still very, because I think it was not long after The Ultimate Fighter, and she was still very early on in her MMA career. How many fights had Angela had going into that Ultimate Fighter? Was it?
She went to the Ultimate Fight. She fought, and it's the story that always does the rounds. People ask the same question. She had one fight.
Mm-hmm.
She had one fight the weekend before she flew out to Vegas to try it for the Ultimate Fighter, and she couldn't get an amateur MMA fight. She was having difficulty getting a pro MMA fight. They ended up upping the girl's purse to take this fight with her last minute. So Angela won that fight 2 days before she went to Vegas, and then addition to be on Tough. And she got in on the strength of having one fight, but a Muay Thai background, because her striking was pretty legit at that point. But then she had that exhibition fight against Carla, where Carla, you know, took her down, tapped her. And there was a bit of an experience there, and she fought Emily Kagan on the Tough finale. So she had two fights proper, and then that kind of exhibition fight on the Tough House. And that was when she came up against Tisha, who at that point had had 6 or 7 MMA fights, but had been in the scene a little longer than that. I'm sure she'd done like Tough Enough and stuff like that, like that kind of amateur MMA competition as well.
Yeah, and leading into those fights that tough season, in terms of Angela and her grappling experience, did she have any at all? Or what was her grappling experience? Was it non-existent at that point? Or
well, she had. I mean, it was the idea was very much sprawl, try and keep it on the feet. But she, when she went to fight Tisha, she'd been working with a wrestling coach, and we'd moved to North Carolina briefly because she was working with a wrestling coach there. Who, you know, good guy, good wrestling coach, but she still lacked a lot of transitional stuff, whether it was that clinch work or that cage work or even just scrambling when it hit the ground. Like, Angela was not a bad wrestler because she was working with a good wrestling coach, but a lot of it wasn't necessarily suitable for MMA. So that's why we kind of moved out to the West Coast, so she could train at Alliance that had a bigger girls team at that point in time and get those kind of reps in and get that experience. She had grappling. It just, Tisha was able to sneak in that little leg reap like 3 or 4 times, keep Angela down. Angela couldn't create enough space to get her off her. And, you know, like, fair enough to Tisha, she played the game. It was, by Angela's own admission, like a tedious fight. But Tisha did what she needed to do to win. And that was her, that was the safest route for Tisha to not stand with Angie, take her down, use that experience. And this time it's going to be very different. Like, Angela's improved leaps and bounds. And even since the last couple of losses that she had, the split decisions, she's really she switched up her training quite a lot. She's got a really good, solid couple of training partners now that really just help her focus on grappling. And I'm just really excited for her to show out. If Tisha thinks she's going to take it down, you know, like, Angela's got a lot of answers for stuff. And I think with Tisha, it's all explosiveness. It's that weird karate thing. Not a lot of head movement, in and out motion, explode forward, explode backwards. So, you know, we've worked a lot of specific striking drills for that, but I do think Tisha's smart enough to play the game where every last 30 seconds in the round, she'll die for a double leg or something like that. We kind of know what to expect. And Mexico City was a weird one in itself because Mexico City, you know, with the altitude thing and people kind of, you can't really stress how bad it is out there. Like, Angela was gassed after, you know, 3 or 4 minutes. And the air, you can... You really tire very quickly, but Angela got pretty major. I mean, you've heard of maybe stories in Mexico City, people get food poisoning and stuff like that. The whole team was with us. Angela got severely sick. She was on weight about 4 or 5 days before the fight even happened. She was like 115, 114. So it was just the worst possible kind of series of scenarios that came up. And obviously it wasn't her best performance. So I'm excited to see it on a more level playing field this time.
Yeah, and I guess the next thing I would be interested to know is, obviously, we've seen over Angela's fights over the last few years, you can see Angela's progression as a mixed martial artist. When you look at Tisha Torres, do you see that same progression? Do you see her as changed very much as a fighter since she's last fought her?
So one other thing that kind of fascinates me about this is I don't think Tisha... You know, her last two performances against lower rank competition was kind of impressive, but it was girls that were outside the top 15, and that Van Buren girl, like, I rated very highly with the wrestling and stuff. And Tisha does have deficiencies on the ground, like, you know, like, you, the same thing you could say for Angela and stuff. That, but Tisha gives up position a lot. Tisha's pretty weak in the clinch. She doesn't head fight too much, and even though Tisha does have a Thai boxing background as well, she relies on trying to punch her way out of clinch or pulling her head out in dangerous situations and stuff like that. Like, just kind of stuff that relies on flailing around a wee bit instead of maybe proper technique, you know? So there's little things we can exploit here or there, but I think with Tisha, those deficiencies are still quite apparent. Like, Tisha still doesn't have much of a clinch game. That girl that she fought on short notice when Angela had to pull out with COVID, that girl was able to clinch and control her just a little bit against the cage, and Tisha again still looked a little uncomfortable in those positions. And I think with Tisha having switched camps from, you know, top team to Colorado to wherever she is now, she's pretty much stagnated. Like, she's added a couple of tricks here and there, and watching a lot of tape, you can see she does similar things to what she always did. She might do a couple of things a little better, like she added in that Superman punch lead in that she likes to do in those charge combinations and stuff like that. But a lot of it's still the same. Like, she doesn't move her head particularly well. She can give up her back sometimes and scrambles and stuff. So I think Tisha is still Tisha. And I think Angela's markedly different and presents a, I mean, I always come back to it, like, Tisha didn't want this rematch. She made it quite clear that she didn't want this rematch. And, you know, like, I know Mick Maynard was very keen for Tisha to take it and was a little peeved with her because she wasn't willing to sign on to fight Angela again after Angela was got over COVID and stuff. So, you know, I think Tisha showed a hand a little bit saying she doesn't want to fight Angela. I mean, you can say maybe Angela's not ranked high enough for her to want to fight, but Tisha's not in title contention at the moment. It's a sensible fight. And I think stylistically, Tisha knows as well that Angela presents a lot of threats that she didn't in the past. So
it's potentially hearing that Tisha doesn't want to fight, is that mentally almost like a little victory?
Yeah, I mean, it's great. Like, Angela was, because it was Angela's first official loss as well. Like, I know she lost to Carla on the show, but she's on paper, that's still Angela's first loss. And Angela was so pissed at it. She really felt like she didn't, you know, I know MMA has wrestling. I know people hold position. I know a fight's a fight, but Angela still feel like she didn't really have the opportunity to fight Tisha. Like, she felt like she went into a fight, got held down for three rounds, and Tisha kind of gamed it a little bit. And again, you can't fault people for doing that if it's a way to win, you know, but Angela still feels like she wants to get that one back and force Tisha to actually kind of stand with her a little bit, see how it goes.
Yeah, and it's shame up to be a fun card. Obviously, we've got the heavyweight bout against Cyril Gagne and Derek Lewis, which, I mean, Derek Lewis is probably the most interesting Instagram in the UFC.
So, you're not a Darren Till fan then?
What's that?
Not a Darren Till fan?
No, I'm a Darren Till fan. I just like Derek Lewis. I love that he's okay.
Yeah. Nah, he seems like a cool guy, and I'm excited for that. I mean, I know they lost the Juliana Pena and Amanda Nunez fight, but I know I think it's Jose Aldo and Pedro Munoz in the co-main or something, which is a good one as well. So Angela's excited to be on the card too, you know, and it's the first time she gets to do like a press conference and shit like that. You know what I mean? So it's cool. It's nice seeing fight week again and being kind of top of the heap, or top, not necessarily top billing, but you get all the kind of, you get all the fun media stuff that comes with it.
Yeah, but it's good. It's definitely good for Angela as well. That, and sure, Angela just always seemed like quite a bubbly, happy person. She just seems like she's enjoying herself out there, which I think is important as well.
And yeah, I'm the bad tempered one. She's the cheerful one, you know, so it levels out, you know what I mean?
Yeah, that's that big Scottish coming out in you.
Yeah. Sorry. Can you hear me okay? Is this thing working?
No, you're good. You're good. Okay, cool. The other thing I wanted to ask you, obviously been in the corner, because you've got that, you're Angela's husband, but you're also a coach and you're in the corner. Is it difficult to switch that part of yourself off, that emotional, the husband part, and just to be focused and being the coach?
It's kind of, it's a strange one because Angela's kind of a workhorse in the sense that she respects that boundary, where I think it was more uncomfortable for me, first of all, trying to tell Angela what to do, because Angela's just so much more credentialed than me. Like, I was an amateur, like, Thai fighter. I wasn't particularly good, but I'm pretty good at picking up on habits and holding pads and strategizing and stuff with the rest of the team. But with Angela, she doesn't really push back too much. So it doesn't make it awkward. Like, sure, she'll lose her shit at me sometimes, like, you know, like when she's having a bad day and, you know, we got to hit pads or something like that, or, you know, like little gripes. But Angela's usually pretty, like, respectful of that. I trust you enough to be in this position, so I'm going to listen to what you say. And it's this time as well, we've actually got Jessica Penny on the same card too.
Yeah.
So it's almost like it's useful to have. I mean, there's only a handful of UFC guys like I work with, or at least like I go out to corner on the regular. So, you know, having done this a few times now, I find I'm so familiar with Angela that it's actually easier to work with Angela than someone who's not fully used to my calls, you know? And, you know, because Angela, when you're a couple, and we've been married for like 10 years or something like that, we're at that point where that obnoxious couples thing where you finish each other's sentences and shit like that. But I also feel like it makes her maybe more attuned to what I'm expecting when I'm calling for something in a fight, you know? And Angela doesn't really, she isn't great too much. I don't really have to worry about her being too sensitive. So that's always my concern, you know? Like, I think we have a good rapport, you know? So I think I think it's beneficial. It's still a little, it's difficult seeing Angela get like bloodied up and stuff like that. And, you know, you got to try and remain calm and stuff like that. But there is this, I think I've done it enough times with Angela that there's now this, there's this point of kind of where I divorced myself from like the husband role. You know what I mean? It's like, this is like go time. Like when Angela makes me do shit, like, well, nice thing is we got girls backstage with us, this fight camp, but like Angela made me fucking slap on the side of the head to try and like get her going before she walks out and stuff. And I feel desperately uncomfortable doing something like that, but I'll still do it, you know? And so there's certain things that you just kind of accept. This is what I'm going to have to do. You know, this is the role I have to play.
It's the beauty of the sport. And what other sport can you slap your wife and it be socially acceptable? There is no other.
Oh, no, right. We used to come back from like sparring, we'd take the subway home in New York and stuff like that. And if Angela's walking around with a shiner or something, not necessarily me that did it and shit, but people would always give me like glare at me and stuff and, you know, give me bad looks and shit like that. But never me. Maybe once or twice. But she gives it back, you know. I think the worst black eye I ever had was actually Angela. We were drilling elbows or something, you know, those little thin elbow pads. Yeah. And Angela got frustrated and fucking cracked me with one. And I thought she broke my elbow or something, you know, and I had like a black eye for like a month or something. Anyway, yeah. So that's domestic abuse for you.
it's a downside of paddleholding. And
I know.
We spoke about Angela's progression, but I want to know more about yours, because you and Angela obviously went through this journey together. But as you were saying at the start, you were a paddleholder, but you've went to over to Alliance as well as Angela's went in there. Just how much have you progressed as a coach throughout that time, being in Alliance and other places? How much have you evolved as a coach?
I think I always kind of enjoyed holding pads, and I thought I was pretty good at it even when I was like just working at a Muay Thai gym. I teach like a couple of classes here and there in New York, Evolution Muay Thai, just a small kind of Thai boxing gym, and you know, good wee bunch of amateur fighters and a couple of pro guys came out of there. I think Angela's probably still the most notable name, but we had a really good coach who really encouraged us to kind of hold pads for each other and stuff a lot. And you know, it's that kind of art in itself, I think. You know, I hate, there's nothing worse than trying to hit with somebody who can't hold pads properly or some, you know, it's awful. But, you know, like from that, like when I came to Alliance, like I was just kind of Angela's husband, but then I started teaching a couple of classes here and there, just like casual classes for whoever was coming through the gym. And then, you know, periodically Eric Delfiero, the head coach, would have me hold for like Wilson Hayes or something like that, or, you know, go work with this person or this fighter. But what I did was very much like a Thai style. So if he told me to go hold for someone, it was, this person has deficiency in their kind of basic like Muay Thai or kickboxing, or they struggle doing just kind of basic stuff, and you can help shore up these little problems they have. Like a lot of the time they were just giving like grapplers to me and having me work very kind of basic combinations, switch kick, hook, leg kick, that kind of stuff. And then, you know, from that, working with Eric and working with very MMA-centric coaches, I started to understand how a lot of the clinch stuff that I liked teaching and things like that could actually be applied to MMA. So there's a lot of stuff in Thai boxing that'll just get you in trouble against certain people in MMA. Like no one's standing in front of people and jogging their lead leg, you know what I mean? But there are certain things you can take from it and adapt it. So now I think I'm a little more well-rounded. Like I understand the positioning a lot better. I understand how important it is to be, I think with Thai boxing stuff, it's because you have a ring and stuff, it's about cutting people off a little more. It becomes a little different in MMA. There's certain things you can't really get away with. Like if you just go out throwing body kicks and you don't want to get taken down, it's just a recipe for disaster. And, you know, even with all that calf kick stuff that people seem to love recently, you don't see that kind of shit in Thai boxing simply because people don't stand like that. But then in MMA, something like that becomes so prevalent because people stand in a manner like that. And little things that you can't use in Muay Thai, vice versa, you can't really use so much in MMA. But it was a proud moment for me when Angela, like we discussed that, it's like that little Thai off balance where someone's like pushing aggressive in the clinch, you just step to the side, trip them over your foot. And she did that against that girl in North Carolina. And that was when Angela swept her. Just a regular Thai sweep because the girl bullied forward, got on top, mounted and finished her off with elbows. But that was really satisfying because we worked on that a little bit. We're like, you know, we should start practicing the Thai sweeps again, you know, on an aggressive opponent. And it's one of these things it translates to MMA, but it's not, you know, you're gripping the head. You're not really going for double unders and trying to trip somebody off of that. You're just, you know, using someone's momentum against them. And it's one of those things you kind of get away from. And I think me getting more comfortable with that has helped Angela get more comfortable just applying what she knows in from Thai boxing and maybe being more comfortable with working that into her MMA stuff. Because, you know, for a while, like, the whole focus is if Angela would clinch with them, it's like, all right, get the fuck out of there. Don't hang it in the clinch. Don't get swept. Don't get tripped. But now she's, other than our last fight where she got a little too overzealous with the knees, got, like, you know, taken down off of it. She feels a lot more comfortable fighting people there. And I think for me, that's been a progression as well. But it just took a while to get used to. So that was a very long rambling answer.
No.
Hopefully you get my gist.
I absolutely do. But that's just one of those things when you just, like you say there, you initially it was using the clinch, you just want to get out of there, but now you can use the clinch to your advantage, and the clinch then becomes, rather than something to stay away from, becomes actually a weapon that you can use against your opponent.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and like you're saying with the foot speed. Sorry, I was going to say it must please you when those little things just pay off, especially in a fight, an important fight.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's cool to see, and it's nice because I feel like she went through a phase where she was more, she was very bouncy on the feet, like she had that kind of alliance footwork that, you know, you see Dominic Cruz do so well and stuff like that, but it did take away from her power a little bit, so... Mm-hmm. I think she's found a happy medium now where she has that elusiveness and that head movement when she wants to, but she's able to sit down and her strikes a wee bit more, which is what she used to do in Thai boxing. But with Thai boxing, it was easy to take Angela down because she's working on a straight line a lot. And, you know, it was easy to anticipate what she was going to throw. And now she's got that trickiness, but when it comes down to it, she can sit down in the clinch and elbow over the top and stuff like that. And that's what we need is her to have a, you know, confidence in that skill set as well.
Yeah, and just last couple of things from me. So in terms of the rest of fight week, how does the rest of fight week look for you now in terms of making weight, and what's your schedule like for the rest of the week up until the fight on Saturday?
I think Angela's got to do some press stuff tomorrow. I think Jess has got to do some stuff as well. So I'll sit around and drink coffee for 8 hours and, like, you know, do the Instagram husband thing where I just take photos for Angela's story and stuff like that. But we'll do a wee shakeout tonight, and then tomorrow, if they want to hit just a little bit to start the weight cut. Angela likes to do one of those, she likes to put on a sauna suit, and she doesn't cut a ton of weight, but she likes to do an active weight cut where there's just like light mitts or a little bit of shadow box and a bit of light roll. And, you know, they'll sit in the sauna for a bit, do the towels, and hopefully they don't have to go to the baths because both her and Jess hate that. But, you know, if they have to do it, they got to do it. So
yeah,
it's fine. But they're not cutting a ton of weight. They're doing about 10 pounds each. So yeah, after the last meal, they'll probably be closer to 8 or 9 pounds. And yeah, it's morning of the fight. She'll do a little shakeout and stuff like that just for the nerves because it helps her keep food down and stuff like that. And then it's fight night. So it's nice knowing where Angela is on the main card because it's not buried somewhere in the prelims. So you kind of know when she's going to go up. But it's nice because Jess is on the earlier prelims, so we kind of know we have a nice buffer zone of time to get them both warmed up properly and stuff. My concern is always that you're going to get, if you have two guys on the same card, they're going to be too close together.
Yeah.
And you have to make contingency plans. You're like, shit, we're going to need this person back there to be warming them up. But yeah, they got a little space in between them, so everything's good. But for the most part, it's just going to be sitting around the hotel. And I got Wilson and Rolando with me are also in the corner, so we'll go out for a couple of beers and stuff like that. And, you know, We like to do we call it like the weight cut party, but we get like a few six packs and shit. We watch Angela and Jess suffer, you know, but we just sit in our asses and drink beer, so it's all right.
So you're applying some form of slow torture?
Yeah, I think it's good.
From a safe distance, I presume?
Yeah, well, I hold pads, but then I have the beer after the pads, but it's like shaking the cage or poking the bear, you know what I mean? Yeah. I feel like it gets a G'd up for the next day, so...
And I've got to ask as well, if the girls need to do salt baths, who's going to be the worst out of the two of them, Angela and Jess, for a salt bath? Who's going to be the more difficult fighter to deal with?
I think Jess is probably, I don't know. See, the thing is, Angela, she never cuts a ton of weight, but she hates being in the bath. You know what I mean? So it's like, you got to distract her. Like you put on like YouTube or something like that, and you can leave like the iPad in the corner or play music or something. Yeah, they're both kind of equally as bad in their own way. Jess is a hard one to keep in the tub, but Angela's like a hard one to get in the tub in the first place. Jess won't stay in long enough, and Angela's hard to get in there initially. So equally as bad, but they're not too bad. They just, you know, they're good soldiers. They do what they're told.
Yeah,
Like, they do 15 minutes, they'll do 15 minutes. But it's pretty crazy. Like, when you've seen guys would do really crazy weight cuts and they can just sit in that tub for an hour and just piss sweat, get up, check the scale, do it again, no complaints. It's pretty crazy. But yeah, those guys, not too bad. Like, if they were cutting like 10, 20 pounds or something, I'd be more worried there. But they're all good.
Yeah, some of the weight cuts and the, I mean, I've heard some salt bath stories in my time, even when James Dillon was fighting. I think he got out of salt bath, no one was there, and passed out and unfortunately hit his head. So it does not look like a pleasurable experience, to say the least.
But, you never done one?
No, God, no. Thank God.
Oh, really?
No. James is obviously the head coach, higher level. James has done some pretty drastic weight cuts. I think there's a picture of him in, I think it was Tokyo, maybe. It was like seen from Trainspotting.
It's fucked up. Yeah, we did a tournament on the East Coast, like an amateur tournament. It's called like WKs or something, years and years ago, and they hold it in Virginia. Yeah. It's one of these like terribly organized Muay Thai things. But me and Angela made weight at the same time and stuff, and we had a photo of her when she was still doing 105 pounds or 106 pounds in Muay Thai, and it was me at 127 pounds or something like that, and just both are like skeletons, you know. And I think I sent it to my mum, and my mum called me and she was really fucking upset, like cried and stuff, you know. So you know, like, parents are always concerned about you getting fed enough and shit like that. But seeing it now, I look like a lollipop head at that weight. And Angela, even at 105, just doesn't look healthy, you know. So it's, I think maybe with MMA as well, like, the physicality is a little bit different too. Like, if you're a tall, rangy Thai boxer but you're really skinny, it's not necessarily a detriment, you know. But with like MMA, it's just, you need that. Like, Angela hates fighting short, stocky fighters because they've always got that lower center of gravity, especially if they're grappling heavy. And you know, Muay Thai, you don't see that too much. You see these long, rangy dudes, sometimes it's a boon to be kind of skinny, you know, skinny and pointy, good elbows, stuff like that, pointy knees. But with MMA, like, Angela did pack on a lot of muscle, and if she tried to get back down to 105 now, she probably looked like death, you know. So
I think you've got to factor in as well, when you start going down the weight classes, like 115 to 105, it's 10 pounds. It might not sound a lot, but it's not like 10 pounds at light heavyweight or heavyweight.
Yeah.
10 pounds at that weight difference is actually, it's insane. It's a lot of weight when obviously the body mass is so small.
Mm-hmm. For the girls especially too, just because I'm pretty sure you see more misses with women's MMA stuff like that in the smaller weight classes. But yeah, I mean, you never seen a heavyweight miss weight, right? Oh, what's his name on?
No, wait a minute. I'm sure I've got one somewhere. How many heavyweights actually have had to cut? I think there's only a few, but maybe Lesnar and obviously Ngannou and stuff like that. But
Tim Sylvia miss, right? Not in the UFC, but I know he came in at like 300 something pounds for like a super heavyweight fight, but the doctor told him he couldn't compete or something like that. I don't know.
It's insanity. But Adam, I won't keep you much longer. Obviously, thank you very much for jumping on the show and giving us a chat, joining us for a chat. And obviously, best of luck this coming Saturday, UFC 265. Obviously, you've got Angela Hill fighting Tisha Torres, and obviously you've got Jessica Penny as well on the card. So best of luck to you and the team and the girls. Again, I appreciate you coming on the show, mate. Thank you.
Yeah, no worries, man. Thanks for having me, dude.
No problem. Thanks very much, mate.